Our scripture text this morning is from Acts chapter 12, verses 19b through 25 to the end of the chapter. Then Herod went from Judea to Caesarea and stayed there a while. He'd been quarreling with the people of Tyre and Sidon. They now joined together and sought an audience with him. Having secured the support of Blastus, a trusted personal servant of the king, they asked for peace because they depended on the king's country for their food supply. On the appointed day, Herod, wearing his royal robes, sat on his throne and delivered a public address to the people. They shouted, "This is the voice of a god, not of a man." Immediately, because Herod did not give praise to God, an angel of the Lord struck him down, and he was eaten by worms and died. But the word of God continued to increase and spread. When Barnabas and Saul had finished their mission, they returned from Jerusalem, taking with them John, also called Mark. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. At this time, I'll read a sermon written by our congregation's founding pastor, Reverend Ken Ramsey, first delivered on January 29th, 2006. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If you were to turn back to the first chapter of Acts, you would hear Jesus say these words, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." And so we see that the book of Acts is divided into three sections. The first tells the story of the spread of the gospel in Jerusalem. The second tells the story of the movement of the gospel in the territories surrounding Jerusalem. And the third tells the story of the advance of the gospel throughout the rest of the world. With our lesson today, we come to the end of the second part of Acts. Beginning next week, we will join Barnabas and Paul as they set out on their missionary journeys. But before we go on our travels, we have to see two things. First, we will see the utter defeat of Herod, a great enemy of the church. And second, we will see the victory of the Word of God. Let's turn to Herod and his defeat first. You may recall that there were five Herods mentioned in Scripture. The first one was on the throne when Jesus was born. He was the one who ordered the massacre of all the boy babies in Bethlehem. The second Herod was on the throne in Judea when the Holy Family returned from their stay in Egypt. It was because he was on the throne in Judea that Joseph took his family north to Nazareth in Galilee. The third Herod on the throne ordered the death of John the Baptist and had a role in the trial of Jesus. But it is the fourth Herod we are dealing with today. We'll go into his background in a minute. The fifth Herod we will meet some months down the road when Paul preaches to him in Acts 25 and 26. The fourth Herod, the one we're dealing with today, was called Herod Agrippa. He was raised in Rome and was a friend of Gaius Caligula, the same Caligula who would become one of the most corrupt and depraved emperors of them all. When Caligula came to power, he appointed Herod to a prominent position, which Herod used to engineer the downfall of his uncle, Herod number 3. Herod number 4 took over, and when Claudius became emperor after Caligula, he gave Herod control over Judea and Galilee as well. So Herod Agrippa came to rule over the same territory as had his grandfather Herod the First. As the lesson begins today, we find Herod in the midst of a serious trade dispute with the Phoenician cities of Tyre and Sidon. He was playing political hardball, and it was a game he was winning. In fact, it wasn't much of a contest at all. From the text, "Then Herod went from Judea to Caesarea and stayed there a while. He had been quarreling with the people of Tyre and Sidon. They now joined together and sought an audience with him. Having secured the support of Blastus, a trusted personal servant of the king, they asked for peace because they depended on the king's country for their food supply." As you know, Tyre and Sidon are coastal cities found on a narrow strip of land north of Caesarea. They had long depended upon their grain trade with Israel, for they didn't have enough arable land of their own. They would sail the seas trading with many nations, but Israel inland was the source of their bread. Caesarea was a relatively new city, a seaport to the south of Tyre and Sidon. It was a city founded by Herod Agrippa's grandfather, Herod I, and it was a city in competition with its rivals to the north. Herod wanted to advance the prospects of Caesarea, one of his own provincial capitals, so he closed down the grain trade to the two northern cities in order to wring concessions from them. We know from Josephus, the Jewish historian of the day, that Herod made his trip to Caesarea in August. The grain harvest was about to come in. The people of Tyre and Sidon were growing desperate, and so they sent a delegation to Caesarea to negotiate a settlement to their dispute. The Bible says that they secured the support of Blastus, a trusted personal servant of the king, which probably means that they bribed him, and in this way they gained an audience with the king. They were negotiating, unfortunately, from a position of weakness. If something weren't done, their people would go hungry. And that accounts for their subservient tone and their groveling praise. From the text, "On the appointed day, Herod, wearing his royal robes, sat on this throne and delivered a public address to the people. And they shouted, 'This is the voice of a god, not of a man.' And of course, this pleased Herod. He received as his due the praise that belongs to God alone." There's a story similar to this found in the Old Testament in Daniel chapter 4. It is the story of Nebuchadnezzar, the proud king of Babylon. One day he was walking on the roof of his royal palace in Babylon, gazing upon the famous Hanging Gardens, one of the wonders of the ancient world, and on the city beyond the palace walls. And as he looked, he gloried in what he had done, saying, "Is not this the great Babylon I have built as the royal residence by my mighty power and for the glory of my majesty?" It was a classical statement of what today we call secular humanism, where everything in life is of man, by man, and for man's glory. Well, no sooner had he said the words than the judgment of the living God fell. Nebuchadnezzar would lose his mind. His people would drive him away, and he would live like an animal in the fields, a brute beast. He would eat grass like cattle. His hair would grow long and unkempt. His fingernails would grow like the claws of a bird. And he would be in this condition for 7 years before regaining his mental and spiritual sanity. Judgment fell upon Herod, too, for the Lord does not change, and he remains jealous of his glory. Our lesson says, immediately, because Herod did not give praise to God, an angel of the Lord struck him down, and he was eaten by worms and died. Josephus tells us that he lingered on in terrible pain for 5 days and endured a loathsome, stinking death. There are great similarities between these two stories. Both men were kings. Both men were proud. Both men were so filled with themselves that there was no room for God in their lives. But there is this difference. Nebuchadnezzar was judged in such a way that, by God's grace, he was eventually restored. Herod was judged in such a way that he was destroyed. Why? I think for this reason. Nebuchadnezzar was a pagan, but Herod had Jewish roots. He knew the scriptures. He'd even read the law publicly in Jerusalem during various annual festivals. And knowing this, he still killed James and tried to kill Peter. He tried to destroy the apple of God's eye. And at the same time, he delighted in himself while he was doing it. But the thing of it is this, in both cases, with Nebuchadnezzar and Herod, those kings served the purposes of God, even though unwillingly. You see, through them, God was glorified. He was glorified because of his grace and mercy in saving Nebuchadnezzar. He was glorified because of his justice and righteousness in condemning Herod. Is there an application for us here? Certainly. While we may not often be called divine, we are often not mindful of the Lord's dealings with us. Think of it this way. We have no talent that God has not given us. We have achieved no success that God has not made possible. We can do no good of which God is not the source. Beloved, when we live without a vivid awareness of these truths, that God is at the center of every blessing we have received, that God is the source of our every kind, decent, or loving action, we are taking glory to ourselves instead of giving it to God. So let us train ourselves up in meekness and humility. How? By training ourselves to look to the Lord, to thank the Lord, to praise the Lord, to glorify the Lord for all we have and for all we do and are that is praiseworthy. You see, the more we look to Jesus, the larger he will grow and the smaller we will become. We need to grow ourselves down until we are like little children who trust their heavenly Father for all things. Herod's death is recorded in Scripture to teach us that we must not glory in ourselves. But there's another very important lesson for us to receive here, found in verses 24 and 25. But the word of God continued to increase and spread. When Barnabas and Saul had finished their mission, they returned from Jerusalem, taking them with them John, also called Mark. Herod had been a fierce opponent of the gospel, but now he was dead. And his replacement, a Roman, had no quarrel with the church. The stage was set for the word of God to go forth into the world. As we ponder that, I want you to think of it in a certain way. Ask yourself, why has the word of God been spreading for 2,000 years while so many other messages die? What accounts for the fact that the word of God has come so far and still resonates in the human heart in such a powerful way throughout all these long centuries? Let me offer you some reasons. First, the word of God is effective. This is what Paul says in 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17. All scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. The word of God is practical and effective. It teaches us what we need to know about God and about ourselves and about the way of salvation. It rebukes us and shows us our sin, our misery, and our need. It corrects us and points us in the way that we should go. It trains us in righteousness, for it daily applies these teachings to our lives so that more and more the life of Christ might be lived in us. The word of God brings spiritual life out of spiritual death. Second, the word of God is penetrating. This is what it says in Hebrews 4, verse 12. Coincidentally, the front of our bulletin today. For the word of God is living and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. The word of God can get through to a person in the way that no merely human words can. People cover themselves with worldly philosophies to protect themselves against the truth of God. They put on atheism. They put on existentialism. They put on consumerism. They put on communism. They put on secular armor of all sorts. They try desperately not to think about who they are, about who God is, and about what their future will be without Christ. But then the word of God is spoken, and it pierces to the heart, and the elect of God cry out in their now revealed sin and shame. What shall we do? What shall we do? Do you know the conversion story of C.S. Lewis? He didn't want to become a Christian. He wanted God to leave him alone. He wrote, "You must picture me alone in that room at Magdalen College, night after night, feeling, whenever my mind lifted even for a second from my work, the steady, unrelenting approach of him whom I so earnestly desired not to meet. That which I greatly feared had at last come upon me. In the Trinity term of 1929, I gave in and admitted that God was God, and knelt and prayed, perhaps the most dejected and reluctant convert in all of England. The word of God had penetrated his armor and had forced his surrender. The third thing to say about the word of God is that it is life-giving. In the book of Isaiah, 55th chapter, we find these words. As the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return to it without watering the earth and making it bud and flourish, so that it yields seed for the sower and bread for the eater, so is my word that goes out from my mouth. It will not return to me empty, but will accomplish what I desire and achieve the purpose for which I sent it." The word of God is bread for the eater, the bread that satisfies unto eternal life. The word of God is spiritual food. Without it, we perish. Beloved, in many nations, Canada included, there is a famine of the word of God. A terrible famine it is, for where there is no word of God, there is no life. There was a time, perhaps, when Canada was a Christian nation, but that is no longer the case. Many do not know who Jesus really is. They think he is a legend or a fable, or they think he was just a historical figure. They do not know that he is alive. They do not know of the grace he poured out at Calvary. They do not know that by grace alone, through faith alone, their sins will be forever taken away. The word of God is nourishing food. We live, as Jesus said, on every word that comes from the mouth of God. What a calling we have to take the word of God to those who are perishing. Fourth, the word of God is eternal. Jesus said, "Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will never pass away." This old world is passing away. There is on earth no continuing city. One day, no one will remember your name. People say they will, but they won't, for one day they too will pass away. Beloved, if the Lord tarries, someday someone is going to look in a shoebox stored somewhere in an attic. They're going to see your picture and say, "I wonder who that was. Nobody wrote down a name." And if they're anything like Ken's wife, Kathy, who hates clutter, out the picture will go. But if you have built your life upon the word of God, though your picture will fade away, you will not. You will have a home with the Lord, a mansion that he has prepared. And you will be among those of whom it is said, "They shall hunger no more, neither thirst any more. The sun shall not strike them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb in the midst of the throne will be their shepherd, and he will guide them to springs of living water. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes." There have been many enemies of the gospel. The powerful, like Herod, have attacked it with the sword. But the more the enemies of Christ have killed his disciples, the more the gospel has spread. Others have attacked the gospel with ridicule. Voltaire, the French philosopher, was one. He claimed that no enlightened person could believe the Bible. It was such foolishness. The very year he said that, the British Museum bought a Bible manuscript from Russia for the equivalent of $500,000, while Voltaire's books were selling in Parisian bookstalls for 8 cents a copy. 50 years after he had said it, the Geneva Bible Society was printing thousands of Bibles on presses that had been set up in Voltaire's former home in Geneva. Some have tried to oppose the gospel by neglect. They've ignored it or claimed that it was a purely private matter and not worthy of public discussion. Some have opposed the gospel by making substitutes for it. We have that in many pulpits and many churches today. A.W. Tozer wrote this 75 years ago. We who preach the gospel must not think of ourselves as public relations agents sent to establish goodwill between Christ and the world. We must not imagine ourselves commissioned to make Christ acceptable to big business, the press, the world, or sports, or modern education. We are not diplomats, but prophets, and our message is not a compromise, but an ultimatum. God offers life, but not an improved old life. The life he offers is life out of death. It stands always on the far side of the cross. Whoever would possess it must pass under the rod. He must repudiate himself and concur in God's just sentence against him. He must repent and believe. He must forsake his sins and then go on to forsake himself. Let him cover nothing, defend nothing, excuse nothing. Let him not seek to make terms with God, but let him bow his head before the stroke of God's stern displeasure and acknowledge himself worthy to die. Having done this, let him gaze with simple trust upon the risen Savior, and from him will come life and rebirth and cleansing and power. The cross that ended the earthly life of Jesus now puts an end to the sinner, and the power that raised Jesus Christ from the dead now raises him to a new life along with Christ. Have you forsaken your sins? Have you given up on trying to justify yourself? Have you acknowledged the penalty of sin you have earned? And have you prayed to Christ, asking that he pay the penalty for you? Repent, believe, live. That is the gospel ultimatum. Herod opposed the gospel. It didn't matter. The gospel went forth despite all opposition because it was the gospel of God, and God's purposes ever stand, and his will is ever being accomplished. It remains God's will to save a people from every nation, tribe, and tongue who will love and serve him throughout eternity. The gospel is still being received because it is the Holy Spirit who irresistibly draws man to the cross so that our old lives may be crucified and our new lives may begin. This is perhaps the most astonishing thing of all. In order to carry out his will, in order to carry his word to many, God used Barnabas and Saul and John Mark. He uses people to accomplish his ends. And that means people like you and me. It is a glorious work. In Christ's name, amen. Let us rise to sing our closing hymn, number 650. I will sing of my Redeemer.
Thank you.
Please remain standing for the benediction. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be and abide with you all forevermore. Amen.